So I'm going to show you a bunch of tricks in this game that you probably did not know. And if you didn't know, you're going to be way better at this game by the time you're done, okay? I'm going to make it so you can easily get into Master Rank, especially right before that mobile release. Watch out, here they come. So let's just get started here. Eject button, you can go ahead and go farther distances than you probably thought you could, but I think everybody knows this one by now, right? But what you probably didn't know is that if you're Mr. Mime, you can hop like all the way over this thing. And you can just surprise! If you are using the score shield, you have to hit beyond the score shield in order to stop it. You see that? You see how the shield was gone, but then I was still scoring? Make sure you complete it all the way through and you hit them after their score shield is gone. Also, in case you didn't know, score shield stacks with other shields, so if you're like a Crustle or a Wigglytuff, you can really abuse that. Or if you have Buddy Barrier, you can really abuse that. I think I talked about this one in a video before, but there's three speeds at which block can go. There is block, which is regular block. There is block, and then use your X speed. A little bit faster. And then the fastest one is X speed first and then use your block. And then here I come! And then actually, if you're clever, you can go ahead and press X speed and then block and then push Rotom right off his little path here. And then if you do that, what he's gonna do is he's going to advance around your goal rather than right on it. So what this will cause is once Rotom gets over here, he'll still take his 20 points, but the enemy team can't score on it. So if you take a look here, it's got the 15 seconds, but if Wigglytuff came to try and score over here, she wouldn't be able to. I'm still not getting any health or shields because the goal is defenseless. As soon as Rotom disappears here, you'll see I get my shields again. But for the time being, they're not allowed to score on it. Make sure you look at your minimap. An easy way to see if Rotom is being taken by the enemy team is let me push him around here, and then make sure you take a look at the minimap. If you take a look at the minimap, you'll see that Rotom is pushed off. He will wiggle when he's attacking other people, or if other people are attacking him. And in case you're not already, make sure you're using L to take a look around and see what the heck is going on. Always use that to scout around. If you're not pressing L and then scouting, you're going to get yourself in a lot of trouble that you didn't have to get yourself into. Oh, yeah. I mean, I did this one before, but did you know that Snorlax can go ahead and roll while he's in his ult? Bonk. Do more damage. Now, I could talk forever about Jigglypuff, but a quick trick when you are sitting here trying to get the double A-Palm out of your lane is you can go plap, then use your defense curl, bounce off of there, and then hit him again, and then they're both gone. A quick way to get a heal off on Zeraora is Volt Switch and then go back home right away. And then as soon as you get back home, teleport, and then you're back. Healed up, good to go. It's like I was never even gone. So Slowbro here has a pretty cool trick with his ultimate move, and I'll show you as soon as Charizard uses his Unite move on me. See how he's unstoppable? I don't know, he looks pretty stoppable to me. A trick you can do to get more damage out of your character with his basic attacks is if you basic attack and then use a skill right away, the animations will kind of overlap, which allows you to get more damage out more quickly. So typically what you do is you're attacking like this, right? And you know, you can mash as much as you want. And this is about as slow as it's going to be. But then with the other technique, what you do is you attack, skill, and then attack, and they'll kind of overlap a little bit, so you burst more damage out. So it's like this. See that? We just got two attacks out with our basic attack and our water gun. So you see the fluffy tail I have equipped? Real quick tutorial, let's go. It has a 25-second cooldown. It activates against wild Pokemon, it'll stun them, and then you do more damage to that wild Pokemon. That damage you do is based off the attack power that you have. Only the person using the fluffy tail gets the bonus damage. However, multiple people can use a fluffy tail at the same time. So if four people stack a fluffy tail and they all just pour damage in on a poor Dreadnought here, he's disappearing in a blink. The bonus damage that you can get from Fluffy Tail is available every half a second. So because of that, characters that do damage over time spells like Sludge on Venusaur or Scald from Slowbro or all this stuff that Blastoise is about to do, those perform really well with the Fluffy Tail. So let's go ahead and take an example here of Rapid Spin with Water Spout on Dreadnought. So I'm going to spin and I'm going to start using my spell and then I use my Fluffy Tail. And you just see how much we absolutely melt this Dreadnought. We covered over two-thirds of his health just with Blastoise himself. So imagine two or three people doing this, Dreadnought is gone. This is a game changer in ranked matches. Now I'm pretty sure Wigglytuff, yeah, sure enough. Yep, yep. Wigglytuff can sing and you won't see the aura. You'll see the icons above your head, but you will not see the sing aura. Another thing you can do with Wigglytuff is if she is singing, if you use an unstoppable skill, that'll make it so that you're countering the notes from happening. So that's a really good way to counter sing. Real quick here, I'm going to show you where everything spawns and when it spawns, okay? Because this is very important information to know. So, down here, these guys, the jungling things, are going to spawn at 9:45. Once you take them out, they'll respawn 1 minute after you KO them. So make sure you keep checking. This core fish and these APOMs down here will spawn in at 9:40, so you want to be up here for 9:40 so you can compete with these. After you get some fighting in, there's going to be a core fish that spawns back here at 9 minutes. And then after this guy's all done, you should be paying attention to your clock, because at 8 minutes and 50 seconds, another very important part of the game is going to happen, which is the bees. And they spawn in at 8:50, so make sure you're ready for the bees. Those are game changers because they really influence the amounts of EXP for each team early in the game. But then if you're a jungler, make sure you're paying attention, because you know how I said it takes about a minute for these things to respawn? Well, around 8:35, you should be paying attention. And if your jungler on the other team or the enemy team's jungler isn't paying attention, you could sneak in around 8:35 and steal their jungle, and then go back to your area and then get your jungle. Now, around this time, 7:38, you have a choice to make, because what you're going to end up seeing is there's going to be a timer that shows up at the bottom and the top of the screen, and those are for Rotom and Dreadnought. You always want to make sure you rotate for Rotom and Dreadnought, but there is something that might make you think twice about where you want to go, because at 7 minutes and 20 seconds, the second batch of bees show up. So, if the enemy team is still hanging out up here and you are low on EXP on a character that needs to reach like level 7 to be effective to Dreadnought, assess the situation and then determine whether or not you have time to get the bees or if you should rotate early to help your team out at Dreadnought. See what the other team's doing, assess from there, see what is the best play for you. But then at 7 minutes, you'll see that Dreadnought spawns in. Make sure you take out that Dreadnought, and as soon as you take out Dreadnought, he will respawn 2 minutes after you KO him. So if you KO him at 6 minutes and 45 seconds, well, he's going to come back at 4 minutes and 45 seconds. One other one I forgot to mention here is these guys. These guys spawn in at 8:45. I don't tend to pay attention to them too often because there's a bunch of other things going on, but if you're being real clean with your jungling or you're being real clean with your lane up here, these guys spawn in at 8:45. Something else to note about these buffs from the junglers, I should have talked about it before, is that their buffs last 70 seconds. So, it might be a good idea when you're doing your second wave of the jungle to maybe hit Ludicolo last, because then that way you have more time available where you have that buff against wild Pokemon to help you secure Dreadnought with a good snipe at the end. And I'm not going to wait for Zapdos. Everybody knows that Zapdos spawns at 2 minutes, okay? If you don't know that, you haven't played the video game. Whenever you take down Dreadnought, you get a debuff on your character for 90 seconds, and that debuff makes you do about half the damage to Zapdos. About half. Now, that can be pretty detrimental if somebody clears Dreadnought right at like 2 minutes and 10 seconds. However, you can clear it with Safeguard from Blissey, you can clear it by using a full heal, and you can clear it by using Wigglytuff's ultimate skill in an aura around Wigglytuff. And if you want to check it out, I have another video about all the different things that full heal can do, and let me tell you, full heal is impressive. So this is actually talked about in the tutorial of the game. I don't think too many people remember it though. If you have multiple people on a goal, you will score faster. You have to start scoring after they're already on the goal. But if you got like 50 points racked up and you got 3 or 4 people on the goal, you're gonna score those like that. If you found anything useful here, please consider subscribing. We also go ahead and do viewer games just about every single night on twitch.tv/swingpoint. Link is in the description for that. If you're not watching on Pokemon Unite Guides, go ahead and check out Pokemon Unite Guides in the description down below. And I'm definitely going to be doing more of these videos, and this isn't everything I know about this game. I'm going to be doing, again, more videos, and there's also just a bunch of other stuff that, frankly, I've already covered before that was in this video, and other stuff that I didn't cover in this video that is just sprinkled throughout all the other ones. So go check those out on these channels, and you'll learn a lot about this game. Thank you so much for being here. You guys are awesome, and then I'll see you in the next video that we do around here.